Hello and assalamu alaikum. I hope that all of you will be doing great. So this is the continuation of lecture number 13, and in this part of the lecture I will discuss about the environmental impacts of geothermal energy. The environmental impacts of geothermal power plants development basically include the change in land use associated with the exploration of the sites and the plant's construction, the noise and site pollution, and the discharge of water and gases that are being released in our environment, and the production of foul odors and degradation of the quality of the site where the geothermal plants are located. However, before discussing these steps, I will discuss about the positive things that are associated with the geothermal energy. Depending on how geothermal energy is being used or converted into a use form of energy, it has positive or negative impacts. However, direct use application of geothermal heat pumps have almost no or negative effects on our environment. The positive effect that is associated with geothermal energy is reducing the use of energy sources that have negative impacts on our environment. It has low emissions, and however they emit 97% less sulfide contents that basically contribute to acid rains, and about 99% less carbon dioxide as compared to the fossil fuel based power plants of similar size. Hydrogen sulfide can naturally be removed using sulfur. Sulfide can be removed using scrubbers in that is naturally found in geothermal power plant. I mean to say that the sulfur oxide that are basically emitted in these power plants can be significantly reduced if we use the technology of scrubbers. And a third one is that most geothermal power plants used to inject geothermal steam and water back into the earth reservoir, therefore renewing its energy source. The most widely developed type of geothermal power plant, known as the hydrothermal plants, are located near geologically hot spots where hot molten rock is close to the earth's crust and produces hot water and steam. In other regions, enhanced geothermal systems are hot dry rock geothermal, which involve drilling into the earth's surface to reach deeper geothermal resources, can allow a broader access to geothermal energy. Geothermal power plants also differ in terms of technology. They are used to convert the heat energy into electricity. The three types of converters were basically discussed in the previous lectures, which included steam, flash and binary. Direct steam, flash and binary, and the type of cooling technology they used. Basically, water is used to cool down the system, and also air is used to bring the heat down. Environmental impacts will differ depending upon the conversion and cooling technology that is being used. Now I will discuss about the negative impacts. The first impact is the water quality and its use. Geothermal power plants can have impact on both water quality and composition. Hot water from underground reservoirs often contains high levels of sulfur and other materials like salts and other heavy metals. Most geothermal facilities have closed loop water systems in which extracted water is pumped back directly into the geothermal reservoirs after it has been used for heat, or heat is used for purpose of producing electricity. In such system, the water is contained within the steel well casing cemented into the surrounding areas. There have been no reported cases of water contamination from geothermal sites in the United States. However, water is also used by the geothermal plants for cooling and re-injection. Depending on the cooling technology that is basically used in the cooling process is making use of water. All the power plant facilities which are basically located in United States use wet recirculating technology with cooling towers. Depending upon the cooling technology, basically I discussed previous, the geothermal efficiency can be increased or it may might be decreased. So depending upon the technology that is being used, the geothermal power plants can required from 4000 gallon to 1700 gallons of water per megawatt for the cooling power purposes. However, most geothermal power plant can either use geothermal fluid or fresh water for cooling. The use of geothermal fluids rather than flash water clearly reduces the plant's overall impact that it makes on the water resources or water use. Most geothermal power plants re-inject water into the reservoirs after it has been used to prevent the contamination and reduce land basically reduce the quality of land. In most cases, however, not all water removed from the reservoirs can be re-injected into the reservoirs because some of it is lost in the form of steam. So in order to maintain a constant volume of water in the reservoirs, outside water from the outside must be used to maintain the steam pressure. The amount of water needed dependent is dependent upon the size of the plant and the technology it is being using for cooling purposes. However, because the water reservoir is usually dirty, it is often not necessary to use clean water for this purpose. For example, the geysers thermal sites in California, they inject non potable treated water into its geothermal reservoirs. Next, I will discuss about the air emissions that are associated with the geothermal power plants. The distinction between open and closed loop system is important with the respect to air emission. In closed loop system, from the well are not exposed to the atmosphere and are injected back into the ground reservoirs after giving up their heat. So the air emissions related to this type of power generation plants are minimal. In contrast, open loop systems will emit hydrogen and sulfide, carbon dioxide and ammonia, methane and other substances including hydrogen sulfide, which has a distinctive odor of similar like a rotten egg. That is the most common emission that is associated with the geothermal plant. Once in the atmosphere, hydrogen sulfide changes to sulfur dioxide after oxidation. So this contributes to the formation of small acidic particulates that can be absorbed in the bloodstream and can cause heart or lung diseases to the workers that are near that plant. sulfur dioxide also causes acid rain, which has capabilities to damage crops, forests, soil, and also acidifies lakes and streams and disturbs aquatic life. However, sulfur dioxide emissions from geothermal plants are approximately 30 times lower as compared to the emissions that are associated with coal power plants. Some geothermal plants also produce small amount of mercury emissions depending upon the sites where they are located, which must be mitigated using mercury filters technology. So adding mercury filter technology will basically increase the cost of the plant. The scrubbers can also be used. Scrubber can reduce air emission, but they produce a variety of sludge composed of different materials, which include sulfur, silica, vanadium, and other chlorides like mercury and nickel chloride and other heavy metals. This sludge is toxic in nature and often must be disposed of at hazardous waste sites that are particularly assigned for the waste of which have this type of contamination. The next one is the use of land. The amount of land which is required by the geothermal power plant varies depending upon the properties of the resources and reservoirs, the amount of power capability, and the type of energy conversion system that is being used, and the type of cooling system that are basically in use. The arrangement for the wells and pipelines that have to be bedded in the system also will contribute toward the cost, and the substantial of auxiliary buildings are also required. So basically these things are associated with the geothermal power plants increase their overall cost. The geysers, the largest geothermal power plant in the world, has a capacity of approximately 1517 megawatts, and the area of the plant is approximately 78 square kilometer, which translates to approximately 13 acres per megawatt. Like the geysers, many geothermal sites are located in remote and sensitive ecological area. So the project developers which are working on the project must take this into account in their planning process. Land is degraded. Land subsidence is a phenomenon which in which the land surface sinks in, sometimes caused by the removal of water from the geothermal reservoirs. Most of the geothermal facilities address the risk by re-injecting the water back into the geothermal reservoirs after the water heat has been completely or partially used. Hydrothermal power plants are sited on geological hotspots which have higher levels of earthquakes. There is an evidence that hydrothermal power plants can lead to even greater earthquake frequency. It has been reported in research works. Enhanced geothermal systems, hot dry rocks, can also increase the risk of small earthquakes. In this process, water is pumped at higher pressures into the fractures underground hot rock reservoirs. Similar technology is used in natural gas hydraulic fracturing. Earthquake risk associated with the enhanced geothermal systems can be minimized by siting plants an appropriate distance, like 1 or 2 mile radius away from a major fault line. When a geothermal system is sited near a heavily populated area, constant monitoring and transparent communication with the local community is very necessary to make the balance, and also to make the population or human population aware of the risks that are associated with the geothermal power plants. Now I will discuss about the life cycle global warming emission. In open loop geothermal systems, approximately 10% of the air emissions are carbon dioxide, and a small amount of emissions are methane, a more potent global warming gas. Estimates of global warming emissions for open loop systems are approximately 0.1 pounds of carbon dioxide equivalent per kilowatt hour. In closed loop systems, these gases are not released into the atmosphere, but there are still some emissions which are associated with the plant constructions and surrounding in infrastructure. For example, the fossil fuels have to be used in the construction work and transportation of the material. So the construction of the geothermal power plant is not ideally has zero carbon footprint. Enhanced geothermal systems which require energy to drill and pump water into the hot rock reservoirs have a life cycle global warming emission of approximately 0.2 pounds of carbon dioxide equivalent per kilowatt hour. To put this all this into a context, estimates of the life cycle global warming emission for natural gas generated electricity are between 0.6 to 2 pounds of carbon dioxide equivalent per kilowatt hour, and estimates of coal generated electricity are 1.4 and 3.6 pounds of carbon dioxide equivalent per kilowatt hour. So this is the example of Grand Prismatic Spring, Yellowstone National Park. This is a, basically a hotspot of a geothermal reservoir, and you can see the steam formation, and this is the, basically the sulfur oxides that are deposited over the land.